We had to move Brother Dusty's chair today and get him a place to sit. I'm not saying anything. I'm just going to go on. Before service, he was sitting up here. I come walking in. He was sitting behind that Jeep, and I thought, what in the world is he doing? But it fits him, though, doesn't it? It does, don't it? And if you'll make a special donation, you can get a picture of him behind it after the service, all right? And, boy, we appreciate Brother Dusty's humor and appreciate him doing those kind of things. Miss Joni, who sings up here, she's not that tall either. She just wears heels about that big. I told her that would fit her tonight. And we're excited about our vacation Bible school tonight. And we've got so many kids that are coming. It'll be packed in here. It'll be crazy in here. It'll be loud. It'll be fun. It'll probably be hot. It'll be energetic. And I tell you, man, it's exciting. And maybe if you're here and you're bringing your kids tonight, you'll get to see it. You'll get to see what it looks like with this place just packed with kids. But if you're here and you don't have children of that age anymore, I think you miss out because you don't see what's really going on. See, while we're in here worshiping, you know, there's like 80 kids up in the other building having church. And so we don't think about that. We don't see all those kids on Sunday morning. They've already been tucked away, so we don't have to see them. Some of you are glad about that too. But it's exciting to see the next generation of people coming up in your church. You know, I'm excited. I just had a birthday yesterday. But can I say this? Matt Burrell's not the future of this church. I'm headed the other way. Y'all get like, not me, preacher. I mean, I'm 70, but I'm staying here forever. But the truth is, I'm on the way out. They're on the way in. And if we don't raise them up, we don't teach them, we don't show them, we don't exhibit how to serve the Lord, if we don't put in them these things, then if we're not careful, they'll not continue this church. You see, our goal, our push is that Liberty Baptist Church exists until the Lord comes back. But if leaders don't come up from under us, it'll be like a lot of churches. It'll be small and dying and dried up. And one day, they'll be doing something else different here than having church. And so my goal and my excitement is to see our young people serve the Lord, to learn about God, and to come back. So tonight, if you don't have anything to do and at 6 o'clock you want to ride here and just stick your head in here and see what excitement looks like, you just do that. I promise you, you'll see some kids that are excited. Well, I want to welcome you here. If it's your first time being at Liberty, I appreciate you being here. We're glad that you're here. My name is Matt Burrell. I'm the lead pastor. I'd like to welcome everybody that's watching online. So many folks visit us online, and some folks that don't live in this area watch us every Sunday, and we appreciate that. And we're thankful for all you that come in by way of the internet to watch our services. We thank you for being with us this morning. If you haven't been here, we've just started a couple of weeks ago a sermon series called Summer Stories. Not just stories, but parables. Parables that Jesus taught, parables that Jesus used. And if you don't know what a parable is, it's real simple. It's an earthly story that has a heavenly meaning. Jesus was good about taking parables and teaching with them. He'd take a parable, he'd take a spiritual thought that was deep. He would take a spiritual thought that was complex. He would take a theology, but he would bring it down into a form to where me and you could understand it. How many people realize that Jesus was God in the flesh? Have you ever sat in a college class or sat in a high school and they're teaching something so deep you're thinking, I couldn't learn this if I've got 3 lifetimes? You imagine the God who made everything coming down to teach. Boy, if he wanted to, could he blow your mind? But that's not the way Jesus taught. Jesus came and he brought stories. And he wanted us to understand. He wanted us to learn. And of course, he gave us a story about a beach house. You know, summertime, how many people ever go to the beach? You get a beach house. You ever do that? I don't get a on-the-beach beach house. I get a couple streets back from the beach house, don't you? Me and Jesse were talking about beach houses because I was going to preach this. Jesse, who sings, we were talking. I said, you ever been down to the beach and walk by a house that's for sale and it's 4 or 5 streets from the beach and it's dilapidated and run down and you grab one of those flyers and you think, oh, maybe I could afford this. It's $900,000. You're like, it needs $100,000 just to fix the driveway, you know, and you realize real quick, this is out of my league to have a beach house. But I love the beach. You like the beach? You know what amazes me, though, about beach houses? And I'm going to tell you this, and y'all don't make fun of me, okay? One of the things that amazes me about beach houses is when hurricane season comes. hurricane comes into the beach, wipes out every house on the beach. And then news reporters say things like this: "We can't believe that this happened." You're like, you build a house 100 feet from the ocean, and you're shocked that something happened to it. I say, you know, when Christopher Columbus got here, and he landed on the beach, he didn't see any wigwams set up on the beach. Because the Native Americans learned a long time ago, if you build stuff on the beach, you know what happens? It gets wiped out, doesn't it? You know what? Our hurricane that happened not too long ago is Hurricane Michael. It hit the Gulf Coast. It run into the Gulf Coast, and it come up around behind Florida and hit the panhandle there in a town called Mexico Beach. I don't know if anybody's ever been to Mexico Beach. I know Brother Dusty was there vacationing right before the hurricane hit. And I'm not talking like 10 minutes before it happened, but that year. He had went on vacation, come back, said it's awesome, you'd love it, man, it's great, beautiful, all this stuff. But then this hurricane hits with 155-mile-an-hour winds. And I've got a picture I want to show you. Show me this picture up here, Kristen. Throw that up there for me. If you're sitting over here, you might not can see it. Can you see what happened there? Yeah. It was mass destruction, right? But I want you to notice something. Can everybody see that house in the front? Everybody see that? Go to the next picture for me. You see all the houses around it? See the one to the left? No, I don't either. It's gone. But that house, look at it. It survived. This house was 150 feet off the beach. This hurricane came in and wiped everything out, including the house that Dusty stayed in. This house was not touched. If they would have had power, the people who owned it could have come and stayed the weekend. That's how nice it was. And so they did this big interview because everybody was thinking, you know what the first thing they were thinking is, how is it that all those houses were wiped out, but that house sustained no damage at all? So they interview the guys. The guy's a doctor from out of state, of course. The doctor said, well, the secret is how we built it. He said, when we were building our house, they told us that code required us to build our house to sustain 150-mile-an-hour winds, but we went ahead and did it to sustain 250-mile-an-hour winds. He told us to put our pylons down in the ground 20 feet. To give you an idea how deep 20 feet is, that tree's 10 feet tall. They said, we're going to go ahead and put them 40 feet down. They said, you need to build the balls a minimum of 12 inches thick. They said, we're going to go ahead and build it 18 inches thick. You know what they were doing? They were preparing for the biggest storm that might hit. You see, the difference in their house, which stood with no damage, and the one right beside it, which is leveled to the foundation, the only difference in the two is how they were built. Both storms, the same storm, two different houses, two different builders, but the way this one was built makes a big difference. 150 feet off the ocean, not one piece of damage done to the house right beside it, leveled to the ground. Jesus is teaching on the Sermon on the Mount. If you know anything about the Sermon on the Mount, it's about two chapters long. It's a long sermon. You think I preach long? He preached long. He gets down to the end of the Sermon on the Mount, and he closes his sermon with a parable about a beach house. Let's look at it this morning. Take your Bible and turn to the book of Matthew, if you will. And I want you to look at Matthew chapter number 7, and I want you to look at verse number 24. Jesus is teaching all the way through this Sermon on the Mount. He's telling them many, many things. He's teaching them on how to go to heaven and how to be right with God and how to achieve eternity with God. And as he gets down to the end of the story, as he gets down to the end of the sermon, this is how he closes his sermon out. Now notice what he says in verse 24. He says, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not, he shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. And it came to pass, when Jesus had ended these sayings, the people were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Let us pray. Father, we come to you, Lord, and this morning I ask you to help us to consider our lives, to consider our homes. Lord, help us to consider how we're building and where we're building and what we're building in this life. God, I pray that you'd help this story to speak to us and that your word would change us from the inside out. Lord, we love you. And Lord, we're thankful to be in your church. Lord, bless us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I don't have a water holder. You see that? I'm going to have to do this. It'll be okay. When we think about this chapter, the Bible says that he's taught them and taught them and taught them, and he's been teaching them and been teaching them, and he gets to the end of the story and he says, listen guys, all the stuff I've taught you, everything I've said to you, if you'll listen to it, I will classify you as a wise man, but if you ignore what I say and you ignore what I teach, I will classify you as a foolish man who has built his house on the sand. But I want you to back up one verse, and I want you to look at verse 21, and I want you to see, that's three verses, and I want you to see something that he says before he gives them this parable. You see, Jesus is warning them that his words are very, very important. Now, you would think that Jesus knew that, I mean, the people knew that Jesus' words were important. They had come all the way out to this mountain. They had taken time off from work. They had sat there and listened to him. They had followed him around. You would think they knew that the words of Jesus were important. And you would think that every person sitting under the sound of my voice today, and every person that's attending church today, you would think that we all realize how important the Word of God is. But many of us do not. Jesus said in verse 21, notice what he said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Jesus makes this statement. He said, everybody who calls me Lord will not be in heaven one day. Now, this is a scary verse, Daniel. This is a scary verse because what this verse says is it doesn't matter what you call Jesus. If Jesus doesn't know you, you won't be in heaven with him one day. How many people realize that most of us are going to be surprised who's in heaven, and many of us will be surprised by who's not in heaven? Everybody understand what I mean? You see, what happens is if we're not careful, we will hear the Word of God, we will attend church, we will come and be around the things of God, but one day when we stand before God, God will say, I never knew you. And the Bible says that some of them will say, but Lord, we did great works in your name. We served you with all these things. And Jesus has said that his Father will say, depart from me, I never knew you. See, what Jesus is doing is he's bringing this to a sobering thought. He says, I'm teaching and I'm teaching and I'm teaching. And if you'll grab hold of what I'm teaching, you'll be with me one day in heaven. But if you don't, you won't. I want to say this before I get the message. It's not going to be popular. You're going to amen here in a little bit, but you won't right now. That you will not go to heaven because your parents go to church. You will not go to heaven because you're a member of Liberty Baptist Church. I think you ought to be a member. I think you should be a member. It's a biblical command to join and be a part of the local church. But being part of the local church will not take you to heaven. You can give money by the mountains, and we'll take it. And we need it. We can use it. But you can tithe and give. I don't care how gracious you are. I don't care how generous you are. I don't care how much you give us. You understand that one day your giving will not get you into heaven. You ever with me? Now, I'm just telling you, you cannot buy a ticket to heaven. There's no tickets for sale. There's no salvation for sale. You can be baptized. You can be Presbyterian and be sprinkled. You can be Methodist and be sprinkled. You could be baptized as a baby and as an adult. You could be a Baptist and get dunked. You can go to the River Jordan and get dunked. But I hope you understand today that there's no amount of water in this world that can save you today. It's just water. Should I be baptized? Absolutely. The Bible says that if we believe in Christ, we should follow Him. In believers' baptism, we should be baptized symbolically. We should do those things. But at the end of the day, it's just water. It's quiet here, right? Y'all okay? Everybody all right? I know what you're thinking. What's he trying to say? I'm trying to say there's people in this church right now that call the Lord, Lord, but you don't know the Lord. That's what I'm trying to say. You say, preacher, you believe that happens all the time? Oh, I know it does. Think about this. How many disciples did Jesus have? Talk to me. 12. How many of them really were saved? 11. So if you take 12 people and one's not saved, what if I went through here and started dividing them up in 12s? And I started pulling one of you out, would we have a good little crowd up here? We would, wouldn't we? If Jesus, the preacher of all preachers, had lost people in his congregation, how many do I have? Probably half of y'all are lost. No, I'm just kidding. I'm joking. The truth is, not everybody who claims Jesus is claimed by Jesus. You understand salvation's important. It's serious. You know what Jesus was saying without saying it in this chapter? There's a lot of you here hiding among the believers. Amen. There's a lot of you here who act like, you talk like, you know all the terminology, but one day God's going to look at you and say, I don't know you. That's scary, isn't it? Scary. And I'm just kind of bringing this out to you because I want to put it right there in your lap. The Lord just convicts my heart all the time that somebody would sit under my preaching for years and not find Jesus Christ. How sad would that be? You say, preacher, is that possible? Well, let me ask you this. Jesus, all-powerful God of heaven, had two men dying beside him on the cross. They only reached one. How many can I miss in my lifetime? I just want to say this to you. If you're sitting here and you say, but I say Lord, I call him Lord, I pray, I go to church. My question is, have you ever really given your heart and life to Christ? Have you ever done that? Or are you expecting just your assimilation into the church to help you? Well, if that's where you're at, that's dangerous ground. I don't care if you're the preacher's kid or the deacon's kid or the Sunday school teacher's kid. I don't care if you take up the offering here. If you have never called on Jesus Christ and given your heart and life to Him, you are not saved and you are living in dangerous, dangerous territory. Dangerous. Jesus said, not all of you are getting in. Some of you claim me, but I don't know you. And then he gives us this story. This story emphasizes this idea. Notice what he says. How many builders are in this story? Two different builders. One guy builds on the sand. One guy builds on the rock. Now, we don't see that there's any difference in the houses. One house might have been the same as the other house. It was where they were built. But he says there's two different builders here. And the two different builders, you know who they equal? They equal mankind. You understand that every person must make a decision on where they're going to build their lives. You say, preacher, what do you mean? I mean that every person's free will, they must decide in their life, what am I going to do with my life? This started way, way, way back with our great-grandparents, Adam and Eve. What did Adam and Eve do? God gave them a choice, and they made their choice. They were standing there, and God said, you can eat of this tree and live forever and be happy, or you can eat of this tree and die. And what did they do? They went down the wrong path. Now, you understand that mankind has been given this choice ever since that day. Every person must make a choice what to build their lives on, where to build their lives, and how to build their lives. You understand that God is not going to come to your house and force you to do anything in your life. Have you realized that tonight? If you don't realize it, you should realize it. God is not going to kick down your door and force you to do anything. You must consciously make a choice to serve God. I want you to get this morning. You will never serve God by accident. You don't trip and fall down one day and go, "Woo! I've done great things for God." That's not how it happens. You don't accidentally serve God. You must make a choice in your life. I'm going to serve God or I'm not going to serve God. And you know what the difference in successful Christians who do great things for God and those who don't? One chooses to and the other doesn't. You know an example of that is Joshua. Remember what Joshua said? Joshua said, man, this people of Israel, these jokers, man, they're crazy. Bible says a generation's grown up here, they don't even remember the works of God. He said, they got some problems. They got some issues. He said, but for me and my house, we're going to serve God. You know what he did? He made a choice to serve God. How about Daniel over in the book of Daniel? Bible says he got kidnapped, carried off to Babylon. They said, look, brother, this is how you're going to eat. This is how you're going to live. This is how you're going to talk. And Daniel said, oh, wait a minute. I can't do that. And the Bible says the guy said, look, you don't understand. I work for the king. He'd kill me just as quick as look at me. You've got to eat this stuff. You've got to do these things. And what did the Bible say? The Bible says that Daniel purposed in his heart, I will not eat the king's meat. And it wasn't too long. Another problem came up with Daniel, wasn't it? That whole problem of praying. You're going to pray to this king. You're not going to pray to your God. What did Daniel say? I can't. Yeah, but they're going to throw you in the den of lions if you do. He said, it don't matter. I can't. You see, Daniel made a choice. Daniel made a decision. He said, I don't care if everybody prays to the king. I can and will not. And how about his friends that come along, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? They said, listen, guys, you got to pray to this idol. If you don't pray to the idol, they're going to cast you into the fiery furnace. And what did they say? We can't do that. I can't do that. I can't pray to that idol. I pray to God only. And they said, but you don't understand, guys. This king will kill you. And you know what they said? He might. Amen. But we cannot. Right. Think about Peter. How many times have you heard the message preached about Peter walking on the water? Amen. We always think, man, wouldn't that be awesome to be out there walking on the water with Jesus, right? That would be awesome, wouldn't it? I mean, I would never have let the disciples live it down. I'm Peter, only second man to ever walk on water. Good to see you. I'd get up to preach, and I'd make the preacher introduce me as the only other guy other than Jesus to walk on water. Peter, come on up here. Everywhere I went, they'd say, hey, what's your T-shirt say? I'd say, oh, it says Peter, water walker. That's what it says. Hashtag water walker every time I posted something. Nobody would have forgot that Matt Burrell walked on water. Nobody. My wife would get on to me. I'd say, hey, easy. I've walked on water. How about you? Don't tell me what to do. I'm not vacuuming. You think people that walk on water vacuum? No, sir. I mean, I'm supernatural. Wouldn't you? Sure we would. But how'd Peter get started? Bible says Jesus walking down the beach, sees a guy leaned up to a ship working on some nets. Jesus stops and Peter, follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. Boy, what a tough choice. Peter didn't know Jesus. He didn't know him. He hadn't been around him long. He just met him. You know what Peter said? I choose to follow Jesus. The water walking would have never happened had the choice not been made. I'm going with him. Amen. And most of us in here, I'm just being honest, we'll never do anything that amounts to much for God because we'll never make the first step, which is choosing to follow Jesus Christ and choosing his way over our way and choosing to go where he wants us to go. Friend, there's two builders in this story. One of them chose the right way and one of them chose the wrong way. And there's two types of people in this room. Some of you in here will choose to build your life on Jesus Christ. And there's some of us here that'll choose to do it our way. If we choose to do it our way, let me just say something. You might have physical success. You might have financial success. You might have all the accolades of your friends and all your coworkers. But friends, if you choose to build your life the way you want to and to do your thing, I promise you, you'll never achieve the success that God wants for your life. I tell people this all the time, and nobody listens to me. Nobody. I'm telling you, I'm going to start getting me some cards that made that on the front it says, Matt Burrell, I'll counsel you. But on the back of it, it says, but if I counsel you, you got to promise me that you're going to do what I say. Because most people, when I counsel them, I tell them what they should do. And you know what they do? They go to do the opposite thing, right? You know what the truth is? Most people read the Word of God. They get the truth from the Word of God. They find out what God wants for their life. And you know what they do? They do what they want to do anyway. And they go, preacher, I just don't know why this ain't working out. I say, I do. If you don't do it God's way and you do it your way, you're going to mess up. You can either have what God wants for your life or you can have what you want for your life. But you can't have both. You can't. It's yard dying. I'm moving on. The two builders equals mankind. It's mankind's decision of what they're going to do or what they're not going to do. But there's two houses. The two houses represent the lives that we build in this world. Whether you realize it or not, no matter if you're trying or not, whether you have goals or not, every person in here is building a life. You say, preacher, I'm 19 years old. I'm not even planning on what I'm going to eat this afternoon. I have no plans for my life. It doesn't matter whether you have plans or not for your life. You are currently building your life. Every person here is. The decisions you make day to day are the construction material that builds what you call your life. And one day, when you look back, the series of decisions that you've made will determine the house that you have built. I was telling Dusty one of the problems I have is I'm so thankful that my kids weren't born in a time when Facebook existed. The reason for that is the videos. I know this is going to sound terrible. Y'all are going to think I sound terrible. But I don't want to see videos of my kids at 3 years old. I don't. So why not, preacher? Because I'll be honest, all I got to do is start flipping through an album right now at home. Just the mere pictures of my young children draws the regret in my life. It does. When I see those, I think, boy, I should have spent more time. Boy, I should have worked a little less and done a little more. Man, I should have been there for them a little bit more. I should have had a plan for them that was a little bit better. I should have invested in them more. And as I look back through those things, I see regret all the way through that photo album. Regret, regret, regret. Boy, I wish I would have. Oh, God, if I had video, I mean, son, I'd just be sitting somewhere crying. Somebody told me one time, said, preacher, I love to go hunting, get alone in the woods, just self-reflect. I can't do that. I get to thinking back in my life and reflecting on my life. I come out of the woods depressed. You're 45 years old, man. This is it. It's all you've done. What have you been doing all your life? Just slacking off? You're a loser, man. Why are you out here killing an hour? You could be doing something that mattered. Self-reflection tells me that the choices of my life have built the life that I have. Every person has a choice. And every choice you make is building the house, whether you realize it or not. And Jesus only puts your lives in two different categories. Notice what the first category is. He says, and everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. Jesus says the first type of life is a life that's built ignoring Jesus' words. He says the first category is very simple. Did you follow me? Have you built your life like I wanted you to? Have you considered my word and followed my instructions? And if you haven't, you're a fool. Was that hard or what? I'm going to make a confession. Can I make a confession? I put this together. I know what you're thinking. It's just cardboard. And it is just cardboard. But it's a complex little joker. And if you put it together, Roger, without the directions, you will soon go get the directions. I got this thing about halfway done. You know what I realized? I don't know what I'm doing. I got extra parts and pieces that I know I shouldn't have. And it shouldn't be laying down. It should be sitting up. So I go get the directions. I pull it out and I'm reading it. You know what I realized the whole way I'm reading the directions? Oh, yeah, that's where I went wrong. Yep, that's the mistake right there. oh, that part doesn't go there, it goes here. When I was a kid, my mom and dad used to get me models. Anybody remember models? Get the airplane built, and your pilot couldn't get inside because you done glued the door shut. The Bible says that if we live our lives without consulting the instructions for our lives, that we will mess up, that we will destroy it, we will be fools. We are building our life on sand, and it will be slippery, and it will not be solid. He said, do not ignore my warnings. Yet many of us ignore the warnings of God. I challenge young people all the time, don't start when you get my age. Start right now. Listen, there's nothing wrong with being 18 and serving God. There's nothing wrong with being 17 and serving God. There's nothing wrong with being 16 and reading your Bible and following Jesus Christ. There's nothing wrong with that. Don't let the world tell you you're too young for all that. Follow Christ. Build your life on His instructions. Follow what He wants for your life. Notice the second thing He says. He says, therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man that built his house upon a rock. You understand that Jesus said, if you do what I say, you're going to be solid in your life. You're going to be solid in your walk. You're going to be solid in your talk. Listen, people will be able to look at your life and say, man, that guy is solid. He said, build on me. Build on me. Let me show you quickly. I got you to see this in verse 25. The Bible says that the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat upon that house. He tells us that the two builders, we see they're mankind. We see the two houses are the lives that we build. But we find that the storms hit both houses. Do you realize today that whether you serve God or don't serve God, you're going to face some storms in your life? How many of you realize that? You're going to face some financial storms. Sometimes you're going to run into a place where you're broke as a joke. And if you need advice, come to me because I'm real good at it. I got it down to an art. I can rob Peter, pay Paul, and Peter didn't even know he got robbed. I'm smooth with it. He don't even know. You're going to run into some sickness in your life, some sickness and some disease, and storms are going to come into your life. It's not if, it's just when. Marital trouble, it's coming. Financial trouble's coming. Sickness is coming. Problems with your kids are coming. Problems in society are coming. Understand today that every person, every life, whether you serve God or don't serve God, you will face a storm. You're going to face it. It's not if. These preachers that are on TV telling you if you give to God that you're just going to be rich and no problems, they're liars. I didn't mean that in an ugly way. I meant they're telling lies. That still sounds bad, doesn't it? They're not telling you the truth. If somebody tells you, oh, just follow Jesus, everything will be perfect. I don't know what they do with people like Paul getting their heads cut off. Peter getting crucified. Jesus getting crucified. You understand that this life we live in's got problems. There's problems coming. There's problems around the corner. You're either in a storm, leaving a storm, or getting ready to go into a storm, but there's storms coming. And Jesus says this, listen, you can either build on the rock or you can build on the sand, but either way, a storm is coming against your life. You will face it. Amen. And finally, He gives us the two results. He said, the family and the life that's built on the sand, that's ignored my word, He said, their house will fall down. Not if, it will. He said, but the one that's built on the rock, the winds can come, the rains can come, the floods can come, the sickness can come, the problems can come, disease can come, all kinds of problems can come, but that house will stand firm. You know what the true test of a Christian is? Not when things are going well, but when things are going bad. When things are going bad. I can look in this church and I can see people in here who have encountered some of the worst storms I've ever seen people encounter. There's people in here who have lost their spouse since I've been their pastor. Some of them have been married very, 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 very long times together, and they lose their spouse to death. They're sad. They're bothered. They're weakened by it. But I look over in their lives, and you know what I see? They're solid. They keep serving God. They keep living for Jesus. You know why? Because they're built on the rock. Oh, not that the storm didn't hurt, but I can see the rock's effect on their life. There's people in here who face tragedy, super tragedy. Tragedy that when I look at it, I'm not even sure that I could face it. And then I see them just serving God. You know what it tells me? Boy, the rock's still solid. The rock's still firm. It still holds you up in the good times. It holds you up in the bad times. It keeps you going. It keeps you moving forward. And I hear people say things like this, "Preacher, I can't believe how they keep going on." Oh, man, it's just because they're on the rock. But I've also seen families that weren't on the rock. They go into problems, and it destroys them. Tears the marriage up, tears the home up. One runs off here and the other one runs off here. They all run from God. And they just sit off by themselves and they're miserable and they're dying alone. And you say, "Preacher, what's the difference?" The difference is where they've built their lives. Church, I want to say this to you this morning, that we're making decisions every day. You got two decisions. Are you going to build on Jesus and His Word, or are you going to build on what you want in your life? You see, Jesus came and taught a ton of people there on the Mount of Olives when He was teaching this sermon. But not all of them went and followed Him the rest of the way. Why? Because a lot of them heard it and went off and did their own thing anyway. And church, I want to make sure that you're not one of those that will hear the word of Jesus and then go off and do what you want to do. Amen. Build your life on the rock. Amen. Build your children on the rock. Build your homes and your marriage on Jesus Christ. And you know what will happen? You'll be that house standing when all the others have fallen down. You'll be that house that's continuing to stand when everybody else is falling apart. Man, people will look over and go, "How in the world did they make it?" You can say, "Because we're on the rock. We've built on Jesus." Let's pray. Father, we come to You. God, we ask You today to help us. Lord, I ask You, God, to speak to our heart. Help us to build our lives not on what we want, Lord, not on what we desire, but that we would build our lives on what You want for our lives. That, God, we would put ourselves in a position that leans towards You and not towards self. Help us to be that house on the rock, we pray. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed, no one's looking around. As we stand to our feet, they're going to sing a verse of invitation. This altar's open. Maybe you're here and you say, "Preacher, while you're preaching, I realize that I'm on the sand. I haven't founded my home on Jesus." You come up here, find a place around this altar and say, "God, help me to build on You. Help me to build on the rock. Help me to choose to be someone built on You." As they sing a verse of invitation, this altar's open. You come right now, won't you come?